Hello everybody. In this session, we are going to start a new unit, that is economic operation of power system. In this session, we will study the introduction of this chapter. Whenever we operate the power system or any system, always cost is of primary importance. And we should operate any system with optimum cost. So our cost should be minimum. So, economic operation of power system is a hierarchical problem or multi-level control. The first step, whenever we want to construct a power plant or we want to build the power plant, first step is to have the load forecasting. Now, it is similar to the weather forecasting where we need to predict how much will be the load in the next 5 years or 10 years or after some duration. Depending on the load, we need to take the decision whether we need to construct the power plant, and if we want to construct the power plant, we have to decide which power plant we should construct, whether it will be a thermal power plant, hydro power plant, nuclear power plant or any other power plant. So always, as I told, first step is to do the forecasting of the load, as we do similar thing for weather forecasting. Then we build the power plant and we have to decide which power plants will supply the load. Out of total power plants, some of the power plants may be under maintenance, because maintenance is the regular thing that needs to be done in order to increase the life of various equipment and to have the smooth operation. Then next comes the unit commitment problem. Now, what is unit commitment problem? Now, out of available units, which unit will scatter the load or which unit will supply the load is nothing but the unit commitment problem. For example, suppose there are 6 thermal units in operation. Out of that, 1 unit is under maintenance. So, out of 5 unit, which units will supply the load is nothing but the unit commitment problem. Then next comes the economic dispatch or economic load dispatch. So basically, in economic dispatch, what we are deciding? We are deciding how much each unit should be loaded. For example, suppose there is 1 unit of say 100 megawatt rated capacity, then should it be loaded to 80 megawatt, 70 megawatt or say 20 megawatt? So that decision is nothing but the economic load dispatch. So there is difference between unit commitment and economic dispatch. Unit commitment is the selection of unit that will cater the load, whereas economic dispatch means out of selected unit, how much each unit should be loaded. Now we will see the definition of unit commitment. The unit commitment is the selection of unit that will supply the anticipated load of the system over a required period of time at minimum cost, as well as provide a specified margin of the operating reserve known as spinning reserve. Now remember, always power plants have a operating reserve which is known as the spinning reserve. For example, if say rated capacity of system is say 100 megawatt, then let us say we have 10 megawatt extra, and that will be required whenever suddenly if peak load take place. So that 10 megawatt is known as the operating reserve or spinning reserve. Now what is economic dispatch? Already we discussed. The function of online economic dispatch is to distribute the load among the generating units that are actually parallel with the system in such a manner as to minimize the total cost of supplying the demand. So there is a difference between unit commitment and economic dispatch. The main factor controlling the most desirable load allocation between various generating units is the total running cost. The factor which will decide how much should be the load allocation of various unit, it is depending on the total running cost. So we should always try to have minimum running cost or the operating cost. The operating cost of thermal power plant is mainly the cost of fuel. Now our main discussion, it is based on the thermal power plant. Now in thermal power plant, main cost is the cost of fuel. Now which fuel we are using? Fuel supplies for thermal power plant can be coal, natural gas or oil. So these are the commonly used fossil fuel in order to generate electricity in thermal power plant. Now the other cost, such as cost of labor, supplies, maintenance, etc., being difficult to be determined and approximate, are assumed to vary as a fixed percentage of the fuel cost. Therefore, these costs are included in the fuel cost. Now what it means? In actual cost, it depends on number of things. One of the dominant parameter is the fuel cost. Apart from that, there are other costs involved, like labor cost, supplies cost, maintenance cost, etc. But to determine these costs exactly is very difficult. So we assume that all these costs are some percentage of a fuel cost, and we are including that in the fuel cost itself. Thus, the operating cost of a thermal power plant, which is mainly the fuel cost, is given as a function of generation. So what it means, the operating cost, it depends on the generation. So higher is the generation, higher will be the operating cost. And this function is not a linear, but it is a non-linear function of plant generation. So for optimal operation of thermal power plant, our problem is to find the generation of different units so that total fuel cost is minimum, subject to satisfying certain constraints. Now, this is nothing but our economic load dispatch. We have to find generation of various units which are in parallel so that total fuel cost is minimum. But we have to satisfy certain constraints. Now, what are the constraints we will study? So basically, there are two type of constraints. One is known as the equality constraint and another is known as the inequality constraint. Now what is equality constraint and what is inequality constraint? First is the equality constraint. First, by neglecting transmission loss, summation PGI equal to PD. So what it means, if we neglect the transmission loss in the system, then summation of generation from all the unit should be equal to total power demand or total power load. This is the very important thing. Practically, there will always be losses. So by considering the transmission losses, we can rewrite the equation as summation PGI equal to PD plus P loss. That is, generation from all the unit should supply demand, that is load, plus losses. So these are the equality constraint. Now coming to the inequality constraint, which says that PGI minimum less than or equal to PGI less than or equal to PGI max. Now remember, I everywhere is the ith unit. Practically there will be many units, so we are writing in general ith unit. Now what this equation says, that generation of ith unit always, it will be less than or equal to maximum generation that it can do, and it is always greater than or equal to PGI minimum. Now this minimum condition is also very important, because if generation is less than that value, then our thermal power plant operation is not economical or not feasible. So therefore, both conditions should be satisfied. Actual generation should be more than or equal to minimum, that is PGI minimum, and it should be less than or equal to PGI max. PGI cannot be more than the PGI max, otherwise there will be overloading and overheating problem. So therefore, both these conditions should be met. So we have to take care of both the constraint, and we have to make sure that our generation of different unit is such that total fuel cost is minimum. Now there is an important thing which is known as the incremental fuel cost. Now this term is very important while deciding the economic load dispatch from various units. Now we will study what is incremental fuel cost. For that, we will plot a graph of input versus output of a particular generating unit. So on x-axis, we are taking the power output in megawatt, and on y-axis, we are writing fuel input in joule per hour. So as power output or the generation of unit increases, fuel input required will also increase, but it will not follow the linear curve, but it will follow the non-linear curve that we have discussed. So this is a typical curve of fuel input in joule per hour versus power output in megawatt. Now there is a constraint that actual generation should be more than or equal to PI minimum, and it should be less than or equal to PI maximum. Now remember, on x axis we have power output in megawatt, and in y axis we have fuel input in joule per hour, but we want actual cost. So we want to convert this y axis from fuel input in joule per hour to cost of fuel in rupees per hour. So let us once again replot this curve. So x axis is same, power output in megawatt, but y axis now it is cost of fuel in rupees per hour, and this cost we want to minimize. So this nature will be similar to this curve. Again there will be minimum generation limit and maximum generation limit. Now what I am doing here, I want to take slope of this curve. Now even though this curve is a non-linear curve, but for small part we can assume it is a linear. Now how we will calculate this slope? So we have to take tan theta. So we are taking at point M, this angle is theta. Now if I take tan theta, then it will be delta Ci by delta Pi. That is increase in cost of fuel, and this is increase in power. So slope is nothing but y by x. So change in y divided by change in x. Now input output curves of generating units of thermal power plant are important to describe the efficiency of plant. Now what is PI minimum? Minimum loading limit below which it is not economical to operate the unit. And PI maximum is maximum active power output of ith unit. The majority of generating units have non-linear generation cost function Ci, that already we have talked about, and we have also seen its graph. Now we shall assume that the variation of fuel cost of each generator, that is Ci, with the active power output Pi is given by a quadratic polynomial, and it is given by this equation. So Ci equal to alpha I plus beta I Pi plus gamma I Pi square. So this is a quadratic polynomial of the form ax square plus bx plus c. Now what is Ci? Ci is the fuel cost of generator I, that is ith generator. Pi is the power output of generator I. Remember, Pi is the active power output of ith generator. Now this alpha, beta, gamma of ith unit are cost. Now what is alpha I? Alpha I includes salary and wages, interest and depreciation, and is independent of generation. So irrespective of generation, this cost, it will be constant, and it is represented by a constant alpha I. Now what is beta I? It is obvious that it is basically representing the fuel cost. Higher is the active power output, higher will be the cost, and it is basically due to the fuel cost. So therefore there is a direct relation. So beta I Pi, so beta I represent basically the fuel cost. And what is gamma I? Gamma I is the measure of losses in the system. Now practically always there will be losses, and we know that losses are directly proportional to the I square, that is square of current. So we can write gamma I Pi square. So it represent the term losses. So this is the relation between Ci and the active power output Pi, and it is assumed to be quadratic polynomial. Already we have seen the slope of cost curve at a point M, it is given by tan theta, that is equal to delta Ci by delta Pi, where delta Ci is increase in fuel cost corresponding to an increase of power output delta Pi. Now incremental fuel cost for generator for any given electrical power output is defined as the limiting value of ratio of increase in cost of fuel in rupees per hour to the corresponding increase in electrical power output in megawatt when the increase in power output tends to zero. Now this is the way to represent mathematically the meaning of incremental term. So we can write mathematically incremental cost ICI equal to limit delta P tends to 0 dabba CI by dabba PI, that is equal to DCI by DPI. Now what it means, so basically incremental fuel cost of generator is defined as limiting value, so we have to take the limit of ratio of increase in cost of fuel, that is change in or increase in the fuel cost, and what is its unit in rupees per hour, to the corresponding increase in electrical power output in megawatt. So this you can understand from the slope, that is the fuel cost curve, and it is a way to represent that we take the limit, and we take the limit in such a way that this term it tends to 0. So if you take this, we will get the incremental fuel cost. Now we know that operating cost of ith generator is dependent only on the power output of ith generator. So therefore we can replace this partial derivative by ordinary derivative. So this term we can rewrite as DCI by DPI. So incremental fuel cost is nothing but DCI by DPI. So incremental fuel cost for ith generator, so rewriting ICI is limit delta P tends to 0 dabba CI by dabba PI, that is equal to DCI by DPI. Now this term DCI by DPI is nothing but the slope of fuel cost curve, so that we have seen. Now mathematically ICI is equal to DCI by DPI, so that is equal to D by DPI of, now CI we have expressed in terms of PI as alpha I plus beta I PI plus gamma I PI square. So we want to take derivative of this term with respect to PI. Now what will be derivative? Now derivative of alpha I with respect to PI, it will be 0 because alpha I is constant, so no term of alpha will be there, plus beta I PI, derivative with respect to PI. Now beta I is constant, already we have seen, and derivative of PI with respect to PI is 1. Therefore this will be beta I, plus gamma I is constant, and derivative of PI square with respect to PI will be 2PI. So we can write 2 gamma I PI. Now what will be unit of this incremental cost? Now numerator is the cost, and cost it is represented in rupees per hour, and denominator is the active power output PI whose unit is megawatt. So what will be unit of this term? It will be rupees per megawatt hour. So let us call it as equation number 2. This equation number 2 is of the form Y equal to MX plus C, rupees per megawatt hour. So this is equation of straight line. So if you plot incremental cost versus the active power output, so it will be a straight line where M is the slope and C is the Y intercept. So if you compare these two equations, Y is nothing but incremental cost of ith unit, slope M is nothing but 2 gamma I, X that is the independent variable is the PI, and C that is the intercept on Y axis is beta. Rewriting ICI. So if you plot graph of incremental fuel cost versus power output in megawatt, so it will be, actually it will little bit non-linear, but approximate from this particular equation it will be a straight line. So A represents actual incremental cost curve and B represents approximate incremental cost curve. Remember earlier curves that we have seen, in that curve we are plotting fuel input in joule per hour versus power output in first curve. In second curve, we are plotting cost of fuel in rupees per hour versus power output. Whereas this curve, it represents incremental fuel cost versus power output. Again, there will be minimum constraint, PI minimum and maximum constraint, that is PI maximum. So I hope you have understood multi-level control problem to operate the power system. We have also studied the unit commitment and economic dispatch. So what is the difference between these two things? Then we have also talked about the constraints, that is the equality constraint and inequality constraint. Then how the fuel cost will vary as active power output, so that is governed by the nonlinear relation or the quadratic polynomial. We have also studied the incremental fuel cost concept. Thank you.